Starting off today with a Pioneer Harvest Stout from Farmery Brewing from Nipawa, Manitoba. Just a nice, relaxing little beer. It's a little bit more effervescent than your average stout, but it's still quite a nice drink. So today, I thought I would do a kit build. One of the two kits that I was sent from Universal Solder in Yorkton, Saskatchewan, some time ago. I built this first one in a previous video. I'll put a link over there. That one was a We Must D1 Mini controlled 4 relay board with some I2C magic and a fair number of adjustable possibilities for configurations and stuff on it. Neat little board. But the other one that he sent me was what he called at the time his brand new Arduino Nano based PLC kit. So this one has 6 relays. It is driven by a Nano. It has with it on the board a real-time clock module, and everything connects to it via nice screw terminals. And as seems to be common with his boards, or at least every board of his that I've seen, it uses this nice black and gold scheme on it with really good labeling. It's pretty sexy looking boards, actually, but the looks are secondary. We've got to get it put together and get it working. So that is what I'm doing today. So just as I'm in packaging things, I spotted this little note on the back of the bag for the Nano. LED L must be removed, which is that one down there. Not quite sure which pin it's connected to, but I will take his word for it. Let's go take a look at the schematic before I get too carried away and make guesses that I'll regret later. So here's the page for this on Universal Solder's webpage. Looks like it's $33.79. Currently out of stock. Well, hopefully he's able to get some in. Last time I talked to him, he was having some challenges with shipping from some of his suppliers, like many of us are. However, here is the description of it. It has 4 analog 0 to 10 volt inputs, 4 analog 0 to 10 volt outputs, 4 digital inputs, either 3 to 15 volts or 5 to 24 volts. So none of that is standard Arduino stuff. Standard Arduino stuff is 0 to 5 volts, right? So he's doing some interesting things to make it a little bit more compatible with a bit more industrial things. It has, and this is the probably its party piece, it's got 6 digital 5 amp relay outputs. It's got an I2C bus that goes off the board and a built-in real-time clock. It's all through-hole parts for easy construction. Woohoo! And here's the manual for it, including some build instructions and schematic and whatnot. This is all kind of the same thing, but he's intended this to be used as a programmable logic controller for things like lighting, air conditioning, greenhouses, water treatment, smokehouses, stuff like that. Or for Halloween and Christmas decoration controls and stuff like that, which the battery backup real-time clock would probably work pretty well for. So the 0 to 10 volt analog inputs are what was used on the old school lighting dimmers and lighting control systems back before DMX 512 became a thing. But you can get that kind of stuff cheap because nobody in the industry uses it anymore, hardly. Or at least nobody in the stage lighting industry uses it anymore. So that could come in handy. The analog outputs are short circuit protected. That's nice. So the whole thing runs on 12 volts DC input from an external source. It's fused at 500 milliamps, but with all the relays cranked on and all the LEDs on and stuff, it says it should be less than 400 milliamps drawn. Then we have some assembly instructions, and I'm probably going to go through in the order that he suggests. Especially when he says things like, don't install this one yet. Some basic first test. So before you even plug in the Nano, make sure that the voltages are all where they're supposed to be, current limited, and make sure there's no short circuits and the voltages show up where they're supposed to. That's useful. Don't power the whole circuit through the USB on the Nano, because these relays need 12 volts for one thing, but there's a lot of stuff on here and you could drag down your USB power supply. And then there is the schematic. Shall we zoom in a little bit and take a look at the chunks of it? Sure. So there's the power supply section. 12 volts comes in. Plenty of grounds on there through the 500 milliamp fuse. We have a 7805 over here creating the 5 volts for everything else. And then just a kind of a brute force little 10 volt power supply here, a series resistor, and a series diode with an 11 volt zener clamping it. So that'll be clamped at 11 volts. This will be 10.4 after the 6/10 of a volt drop there. Okay, and some extra power supply smoothing here and here. Down here we have the opto-isolated digital inputs. Looks like they just use the common ground. Yeah, they just go to the common ground of the entire circuit. So you just put zero. No, this is digital input, so this will just be a binary 1 or 0. The output transistor on these opto-isolators has LEDs on them so that you know when you're getting a signal in, and then they go down to an assortment of digital pins on the Nano. Here's the 4 analog inputs, and they look like they've got a voltage divider built out of 2 of these Sill resistors. So that's how you get 0 to 10 volts. Input onto analog inputs that only really like to see 0 to 5 volts. And then the real-time clock down here is the pre-made module with a couple of external components and the external I2C, which also services that. Up here we have the analog outputs, which are coming from some of the PWM outputs on the Arduino. So we have some pull-down resistors here, 22K. We have some 6.8K series resistors to the capacitor, so those resistors in that capacitor will be smoothing out the PWM, and then the op amps will be buffering it and providing a little bit of current drive to these analog outputs, which are further smoothed by these capacitors over here. Actually, probably that RC circuit there. And then we have the relays. They have this UN2003, which is a Darlington transistor driver array, providing the current drive and buffering between the Arduino itself and the relay coils. And their built-in diodes will be clamping the inductive kickback. That's nice. So that's all done inside there. And then we have some LEDs with, again, one of those Sill resistors indicating when these are supposed to be on. So here's our starting components, two 10K resistors, the little crystal, and the zener diode. So I've got the board sitting sideways in here just because the little grippers are going to foul some of the things on the edges here. So it's going to make it a little bit more challenging to read, but it's going to make it easier to work. R9 and R10 are these two over here. Some people are really picky about getting the resistors with the bands all in the same direction. I am not one of those people. So D1 is the zener diode. Where does it go? It's part of the power supply. Well, there's D1 there, okay. The band goes that way. That is important electrically. Cosmetically, doesn't care, but electrically it's important. And the crystal, that goes down near the real-time clock. This is harder to read sideways than I thought. XT1 right there. Now these guys aren't polarized. It's literally just a chunk of quartz cut to a very specific dimension. So that's going to go like that. And we commence the soldering. I am, of course, going to be using the T12 soldering iron that was generously gifted to me by a viewer. Just because it's a good iron. Nip these off as I go. That one looks like it's a little bit low on solder, but the through hole is absolutely full, so it's not a big deal, except for cosmetics. Next, he suggests to make your decision about the input voltage range for the digital inputs. I think I want the lower voltage, 3 to 15 volts, so I need 4 1.2K resistors. So I believe those are the 1.2s. So it should be between the pin with a dot on it and any other pin. Yeah, there we go. So that's how those work. And I decided it just made more sense to turn it up this way until I absolutely need to. So there's R2. That end has a band on it, so I'm guessing that's where the dot goes. Let's make sure that's in place. Yep. Proceed with everything else. Next, thicker until everything's assembled. So I guess just for fun, I will throw these in pretty much in the order that they show up on the parts list. Unless there's something really huge or something, but I think that makes sense. So that would be these three little electrolytic capacitors here. Plus sign goes to that side. And since these are all part of the power supply, you really don't want to get them backwards because they will just go boom. Capacitor 3 is there, positive is that way, so negative goes on that side. So next we have C4, 5, 7, and 10, 2.2 microfarad capacitors. So C4, C5, C7, C10. Those are all part of that analog output filtering circuit. Next, we'll do the four ceramic capacitors, C6, 8, 9, and 11, 100 nanofarad. And these guys go over here, so I'm going to have to slide my board around again. That's why I was doing it sideways, but it was so hard to read. I think I will probably move to sideways again at some point here, just for access. And the circuit doesn't matter, this is just for personal convenience. Next in, four yellow LEDs. No, D7, 8, 10, and 11 are right there. Anode is marked on the left. Anode being the positive, being the longer lead. I'll stuff those guys in. For these LEDs, I'm going to solder one pin. And push on it with my finger from the other side until it's up flush. And then solder the second pin. And there we go. All nicely aligned on this on the front side. And then the six red LEDs, which are the ones that indicate the relay status. And those are down here by the relays. Again, anode and cathode marked. Anode positive, long lead. Let's get that one in 4007 diode in next. And that's D3 up in the power supply section. Band goes to the top. Now I'm going to start skipping around a little bit. I'm going to put in that 1-watt resistor R1. Which is also part of that little power supply circuit there. It's in series with the diode beside it. And also with the Zener diode. So R2 I've already put in. So R3 is another one of those 1-2-2 resistors. And then R4 is a 6-pack of 2.2K. R5 and 7 are 4 resistor 27K. And R6 and 8 are a 4-piece, again, 22K, and conveniently, the code number that's written on them is all right there. So 273 is one of the 27K, and there's two of these that need to go in. That's R5 and R7. There is R7. Oh, wait a minute, there's R5 right there. Just when you're not looking for it, you find it. I think I'm going to do this the unorthodox way, and I'll just do them as I find them. So R8, let's do that one next. R8 is a 22K or 223. What's right beside it? R11. R11 is a 6.8K or 682. Where's my dot? That end. Always remember that those guys, unlike normal resistors, they also have a goes one way only. R4 is a 2.2K, otherwise known as a 222. One nice thing about those sill resistors is there's no lead trimming to do. They're just there. What's next? We have three more down here. We have 12, 13, and 6. 6 is a 22K, 223. 12 is also a 22K, but in a bigger pin count. And R13 is a 300 ohm resistor, 331. And that goes in there, and that should be the last of these little sill resistors. Oh, get in there, you. That's tight. Yes, I'm being brave and or stupid trying to solder all three of those at once. I don't know how well that's going to go. It's kind of going to be a forest of pins. So now I'm going to reorient the board back sideways again, just because I'm starting to get crash into things. I think I'm going to start soldering some of these taller components. So I really want to leave the ICs until as close to last as possible. So in that case, I'm going to do this voltage regulator board. Initially, when I was unpacking it, I said that this was the real-time clock. That's wrong. That's the real-time clock there. It goes there. So now this guy here, which way does it go? By the drawing, it looks like it goes that way, but
So in the parts description, it says IC1 is a 7805, but in the photo and in the kit, there it is this little buck regulator here. So I guess I'll go with that, and he shows it with the circuit board side facing the relays.
Like that. Interesting choice to put the buck regulator on there. It's not going to burn as much power, not going to create as much heat. I guess that's a reasonable enough choice. So over in that corner, the other thing I'm going to put in is a fuse right now, because it's not going to be in the way of anything else. And in the instructions, he suggested that the fuse holder would be easier to solder if the fuse was in it. Which makes sense, that'll get the spacing correct. Well, there's not much left but the ICs and header pins and stuff. Okay, now let's start throwing ICs in. I don't like doing these without sockets. Not that I don't trust my soldering, it's just it's a pain in the ass if you have to take something out. If something breaks or whatever. Did I double check? Yeah, notch goes that way, pin one's over there. Okay, I want to be in and out fairly quickly with these. And I'm also going to go corner to corner rather than blitz my way up one row just to spread out the heat. Take a pause between each pin just to spread out the heat. And modern ICs are relatively tolerant, but it's always good practice to just be a little bit careful with them, especially when they're not socketed. Okay, so that's the real-time clock chip. What is that one over there? That is IC5. IC5 is the LM224 quad op-amp, which is part of the analog circuit, the analog output circuit. And I guess that makes a certain amount of sense because that's also where those capacitors and resistors for the analog output circuit are. What do we got over here? IC2 and IC3. I think 2 is probably the next one just because of where it is. If I do 3 first, it's going to be really ugly to get in there. And IC2 is the LTV847 optocoupler. And this one doesn't have the notch indicating where pin 1 is, but it does have a dot over pin 1. And on the board, there's a dot for a pin 1 indicator too, so that's how that guy goes. You can see how tight it would be if this other chip was already in place, right? As it is, soldering that one in is going to be a bit of a bear. It's kind of challenging going up beside these pins from that sill resistor, actually. Now then, the last IC in is this ULN2003, which is that Darlington array to drive the relays. And it does have both a notch and a dot to find pin 1, so that's nice. Let's take a quick peek at that, make sure I haven't bridged anything. That one too. No, it looks good. Relays, I guess, next. Oh, and I've also got some header pins for that over there, the I2C. See if I can do this with one hand again. Hold the device from the other side with one finger, solder with a couple of fingers. I'm still not as dexterous at doing this as Big Clive is, doing 6 things with one hand. Oh, what is that? That is a resistor, R3. What is R3 and why didn't I put it in? Ah, R3 is a 1.2K. Okay, why did I miss that one? I should have put that in earlier when I had room. Okay, the dot goes to that end. So I do also have the header pins for the Nano to put in too. But I think I will just set the Nano on top of it just to help align the pins and hold everything in place. Could probably solder it all together in one shot here. Okay, so there that is. Yeah, I think I have to do this bit of acrobatics again. So this side is... Okay, I'll just push that up while I reflow that. Okay, and if I can get a couple in the back here before the Nano falls off, and that isn't right, that one needs pushing up. And that one too. Okay, so now the female header pins are held in place just by the 4 corners. So now I think I will do the same thing on the male header pins, just on the 4 corners. And that way everything is aligned and parallel. See that? Now I can pull the Nano out, I think. Its pins are going to stay aligned, except for they didn't. Oh, I see what happened. They did stay aligned. They just pulled up. Or all the ones that I didn't solder pulled up anyways. But that's okay. I can just smush it back down and get them all even again. There we go. But first, I'll finish soldering up these female header pins on here now that they won't move. Let's do the same thing with the Nano. Actually, just to keep it in alignment, just in case, I'll drop the Nano into a breadboard. That's always a good way to keep them in alignment, too. And while I'm messing around with the Nano, I need to take this LED L off, like it said in the instructions. So, I don't know why I didn't realize it before, but LED L is the pin 13 LED. And pin 13 is being used for some purpose on this circuit, so... Okay, there it is. Make sure I haven't created a short. No, that looks reasonable enough. Okay. Meanwhile, up here, about all that's left is the screw terminals and the relays. See, these relays just drop on there. The coil is these two pins at this end, and these two are the normally open contacts. These are just normally open relays. They don't have a normally closed on them, which for the purpose this thing is intended for is probably not a big deal. Should I put in the battery holder next? Sure, why not? That is the absolutely tallest thing on the board. So if I set that down, it should just hold itself there, right? Right. So I think I'm good now, except for these screw terminals. One of them, I think, is a 4-pin. Yeah, that's a 4-pin there. Or two 2-pins that just slot together like that. There we go. I think I might go back to the board holder for these guys. It's at a jaunty little angle, but we'll cope. And that, I think, is the last of the soldering. I'm just going to give this guy a quick once over with the magnifying glass to make sure I haven't done anything stupid on the backside. Okay, as far as I can tell, everything looks good from the soldering side. I mean, it's not beautiful and pretty, but it's also not going to fall apart. So let's give this guy 12 volts and see what happens. Plus 12 volts and 0 volts. I have 12 volts on here, current limited just over 500 milliamps. Power on. Okay, there are no power LEDs on the board, so we have to go looking at it the hard way. First of all, let's see if there's 10 volts over here. 10.4. That's pretty much what we predicted based on the schematic, so that's good. Where does 5 volts show up? One pin of this should be 5 volts, and there it is there. That should be 12. That's the ground. So we've got our two voltage supplies. Where does 5 volts go to the Arduino? Before that should be 5 volts. And it is. Okay. That's good. So that means that if we power that off, plug in the Arduino, and power it back on again, we should get at least the power light on the Arduino to come on, right? And it does. Woohoo! Oh, hey! See this over here? That is digital 4 output. And it looks like there's a blink sketch running on this thing.
Yeah, pin 13 is connected to one of the inputs, one of these opto-isolated inputs, but it's also got an LED on it. And that is, in fact, flashing. Perfect. That says that a lot of things are working.
So I suppose the next thing to do is throw a little bit of software at this thing and see how well it works. The important thing to know is this little mapping over here, which shows which physical ports on the board match up with the Arduino ports, both the analog and the digital. So I will wander off and write some bad code and find some examples and things and come back in a little bit here. As I was preparing to upload some code, I noticed this little bit here, and since he's got it flagged in bright red text, it probably is important. Don't supply power to the through the USB to the Nano when it's plugged into the unit and it's powered on. To program the Nano, remove it or turn off the power, the 12-volt power supply. I went one step further just to protect my computer, just in case.
I'd built myself a little condom kind of wire here for the USB. So this is just a straight through USB cable with the 5 volts disconnected. So we still have ground and the two datas. So when I connect the computer, when I connect that up to the USB port that goes there, the computer isn't supplying power to that. The only way for this thing to get its power is from the onboard regulator here. So that way I can't accidentally power both of them together. Just saves me from doing something stupid. So right there, you can't see it, but I have the computer connected right now and there's nothing happening. When I turn the power supply on, the 12-volt power supply to here, now this is on.
So the first bit of code that I'm going to throw at this thing is just a test for the DS1307 real-time clock. And this just uses this particular library, which is one that I happen to have installed. There are several other real-time clock libraries. I just grabbed this one because it was handy. So I'll pick the right USB port and upload that. We'll take a look at what's on the serial monitor here. So it is now this every 10 seconds it reads the time from the RTC and prints it back here. And that, as you see, is within a minute of the computer's time. That sketch basically just sets the RTC to match the computer, the compile time. So now you only have to do that once until the battery gets replaced or something like that. Anyway, so this shows us the RTC working. I'm not going to go any further with the RTC right now because this is much more advanced code than I am willing to wrap my mind around just for a demo. But here is the demo sketch that I spent way too long writing. It's horribly inefficient, but it basically tests all the pins, which is all I really wanted to do. So first I define all the pins, the digital in, the relays, the analog in, and the analog out, based on this here, like I said before. And then I ripped off the blink without delay example and created two different instances of it, one with a 1 second delay and one with a 1.5 second delay, and assigned those to relay 5 and relay 6. And set them up, all the pins up as either inputs or outputs, as you do. And then down in the loop, I'm just reading the 4 analog ins, which, as you recall, go through a resistive divider to set the voltage, the input voltage, anywhere from 0 to 12 volts. And then I map that to the same analog outputs, which again, if you recall, are going through these op amps here and the capacitive and resistive smoothing. Theoretically, the voltage that we put in on the analog input should show up, plus or minus, kind of, sort of, on the analog outputs. And then I'm just digital writing to the first four relays based on whatever is at the digital inputs. And I notice that these are inverted. A low on the input gives you a high on the relay, so I just inverted them back again so that the high on the input gives me a high on the relay. And then this is the blink without delay that's controlling relays 5 and 6. And again, one of them's on a 1 second blink and one of them's on a 1.5 second blink. So let's send this. And here it is. And there's relays 5 and 6 blinking, relay 5 on a 1 second, relay 6 on a 1.5 second. And then I can take the 10 volts and apply that to the first four digital inputs, 1, 2, 3, and 4, and that turns on its respective relay as we expected it would. And then on the analog outputs, if I give it 10 volts on analog 1, it's 9.5. Okay, on the output, that's not bad. Same thing on 2. Same thing on 3 and on 4. Let's try that with a slightly different input voltage just for the fun of it. Let's try it with this battery here. So I've got it connected just to the common ground, so it's putting out about 4 volts right now. So on analog input 1, I got 4 volts, and analog output 1, I've got 4.08 all the way across. That's pretty good. And actually, that 4 volts is enough to hit the optoisolators and drive those inputs to the relays as well. So it doesn't have to be too high a voltage. So that's, obviously, you could program it to do a whole bunch more. If for those of you who know how to program, you could easily, probably, make the RTC control the relays in different combinations. You could have different analog input sensors either control the relays to do different things or to send out different analog voltages. It's a fairly capable little board, fairly versatile. And with the higher voltage and the isolation on the inputs and the outputs, I think it expands the capabilities of the Nano quite nicely. Hope you found that interesting. If you have any questions or comments, as usual, down in the comments section. Well, thanks everybody for watching, and thanks especially to Universal Solder for sending me this for evaluation and for our amusement. I will talk to you later.